Good morning. Welcome to Woodward Park Baptist Church. We are excited to come together and worship our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And every Sunday, what we do when we gather together is we're remembering Jesus' death and resurrection. But especially on this Easter Sunday, we are very specifically remembering Jesus Christ's resurrection from the dead. So I think some of you would be disappointed if I didn't say, He is risen. See, I knew you a lot would be disappointed if we didn't do that, right? But we're glad you're here to worship with us this morning. If you're here for the first time, there's a card in the seat in front of you. If you would fill that out for us and take it to the Welcome Center, we have a gift we'd like to give you as just a thank you for being with us. Let you know a little bit about the church. And please, anybody that would like to communicate prayer requests with us, please use those cards to do that so we can be praying for you specifically throughout the week, okay? Now, just one announcement this morning, and that is that next Sunday, we have a new member lunch. And so if you're interested in possibly becoming a member of the church, or if you just want to come and find out more about who we are, if you'll sign up at the Welcome Center, we'll have a lunch right after the service and then spend a few hours together just talking about who we are as Woodward Park Baptist Church, okay? We are excited this morning to have our children's choir lead us into worship, so we're going to let them do that.
Thank you. an Easter service, say amen. Amen. And then say, he's alive.
He's alive.
All right. Would you stand up? And we're going to sing a song now that says, because he lived, he died, and came back to life, we have new life. And this song says, I was buried beneath shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? But he called me out of the grave. Let's sing it together.
Our scripture they're reading this morning is out of John chapter 11. So if you'd like to read along with us, our scripture reading is going to be John chapter 11, verses 17 through 27, where we see in the book of John, Jesus really last and greatest miracle in his ministry before he is in Jerusalem, and then the cross and the resurrection, which we celebrate this morning, and almost a prelude to that. So we see in verse 17, John tells us, "Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give to you.' Jesus said to her, 'Your brother will rise again.' Martha said to him, 'I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day.' Jesus said to her, 'I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?' She said to him, 'Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world.'" Will you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we praise you for your goodness. We praise you as one in your goodness who's not left us without hope, left us without help in our world that is full of sin and full of suffering. And as we see in the what we just read, full of death. And we praise you for your grace. We praise you for sending your Son, Jesus. Lord, those of us who weep like Martha, we praise you and thank you that we can experience your promise of resurrection and eternal life. We praise you that you are a God who saves, that we gather this morning to remember that the tomb is empty. We come this morning not looking at ourselves, but looking at what you have done in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that he rose from the dead, and that through faith in him, that we can have life in this new resurrection life that he promises. Thank you that in Christ, that because of the grace and life that he gives, that we have access to bring our prayers and petitions with confidence and boldness to you this morning. Father, we want to pray this morning for our missionaries. We pray for our 3,500 missionaries with the Southern Baptist International Mission Board as they are sharing the good news of Jesus' resurrection, of the eternal life that that resurrection brought to the unreached peoples and unengaged places around the world. Father, we pray for the churches that they are planting and supporting as they are meeting this Lord's Day, this Easter Day, that you would give them boldness in these churches to proclaim the good news of Christ's resurrection this Easter Sunday and every Sunday, so that many from these unreached areas, these unengaged areas, would hear the news of the resurrected Jesus, the salvation that he brings, and that they would place their faith in Jesus, that he is the Christ, the Son of God. Father, we pray especially for so many of our Christian brothers and sisters around the world in some of these areas where our missionaries are laboring that have to meet in secret this Easter because of the danger of persecution. Father, we pray that in the midst of that, that you would encourage them. We would remember them and pray that you would empower them. That even in the midst of the danger they face for living out the hope they have this Easter morning, that you would empower them as your witnesses to bring that good news to others in those areas who need to hear about the risen Savior. Father, we pray specifically for the Lakaz family, our missionaries that minister in Chiang Mai, Thailand. We pray that you would strengthen their witness to their neighbors, to the orphanage where they're volunteering, to the university where they minister. We pray that you would strengthen the churches that they work with. We pray for the pastors of Mahakon and the Acts of Grace churches, that you would help them grow in the grace and knowledge of your word and the boldness to testify to the risen Savior in their community. Father, we also pray for the fellow gospel preaching churches in our area. We thank you that Lord, as we meet to celebrate the risen Lord, that we do not meet alone. Lord, that we thank you for the faithful churches throughout our area. We pray this morning for Pastor Mel at Faith Community Church, for Pastor Moses at New Life Baptist Church, for Pastor Brandon at Grace Church Madera, for Pastor Matt at Free Grace Church. Father, we pray this morning as they would reflect and meditate on the empty tomb and the risen Lord, that you would revive their hearts with joy and with wonder at the resurrection, that you would strengthen them in their holiness and love, that you would embolden them in their witness for your glory in their churches and around our community. And Father, as you've taught us, we would continue to pray for those you place in authority over us. We pray for those that you place in leadership in various offices in our city and our county. We pray this morning for Mayor Dyer and Mayor Ashbeck and for the members of the city councils and other city and county leadership. Father, we pray that you would grant them wisdom as they would lead, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. Father, we pray this morning for our church. We pray that you would awaken our hearts once again, that this really is good news that we celebrate. Father, we pray that you would remove the callousness and hardness and help us to rejoice once again at the empty tomb and the risen Savior. Father, we pray that the good news we celebrate this morning would not just be something we know with our minds, but that you would transform us with this good news, that you would strengthen our resolve for holiness and devotion to the Savior, that you would embolden our witness as we would seek to make disciples of all nations, sharing this good news of salvation with those around us in our area here in Fresno and Clovis, and raising up missionaries from our church to bring this good news to the ends of the world. And so, Father, as we continue in praise, praise through our singing, praise through the study of your word, praise through the giving of our offerings this morning, we recognize that you are worthy of it all. And so we pray that, Lord, that you would use this praise for your glory, that you'd use this offering for your glory, both here in our church, in our community, and around the world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Believe the supernatural part of the Bible. Jesus came back to life. That's supernatural. But you know something else that's supernatural? He brought us back to life. And when we gather to worship Him with His Spirit here, something supernatural happens. There's a verse in that says this. Acts 4:12. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. There's no other name under heaven but Jesus. Say that word. Would you just say Jesus? Say it again. We're going to sing about that name. Would you stand? I want you to listen as you stand. As our singers on the stage sing through the first verse in chorus, just listen and worship. And then we'll join them. We'll repeat that. Sing about Jesus. You were the Word at the beginning.
You are the Word in the beginning. One with God.
Beautiful name it is.
Father, today we want you and your Son Jesus Christ to be lifted up in everything that happens. So search our hearts now as we listen to your word. And Father, would you convince and convict us of sin in our lives that we need to repent of so we can serve you more faithfully. In Jesus' name, amen. Be seated.
And children 3rd through 6th grade are dismissed at this time. If you guys, 1st through 3rd, what did I say? 1st through 3rd grade. You guys know who you are. You can make your way over to Adventure Club. Open your Bibles, if you would, to Matthew chapter 28. We're going to begin this morning in verses 18 through 20. And this is the very end of the book of Matthew. And if you've ever, sometimes there are TV shows or movies that begin, and right as they begin, they drop you into a really tense situation, and you're kind of scrambling, wondering what in the world is going on. And then they pause, and then you'll see something that maybe says 3 days later, or 3 days earlier, or 3 months earlier, or something like that, that brings you to where that point is. And that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to begin at the end of the story here in Matthew 28, and then go back and see how is it that we ended up here. So if you would, look at Matthew chapter 28. I'm going to read verses 18 through 20 to start us this morning. It says, "And Jesus came and said to them, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you even to the end of the age.'" This is God's perfect and holy word for us this morning. Let's pray. God, we pray that as we look at your word, that we would be in awe of who you are and grow in our love for you. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. So if you've been around church very much, you know that we call this the Great Commission. This is what Jesus at the end of the book of Matthew is commissioning his people to go and do. And the reason I want to start here, and the reason I said that this is really starting us off at the end of the story, because if you just take this, these few verses out of context and you disconnect them from Jesus, these are pretty amazing things. He says, first of all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. And Jesus had, throughout his ministry, he had taught, and people were amazed, and they would say, well, he teaches with authority, not like the scribes and the Pharisees. But here he's saying, all authority has been given to me. And he says, on heaven and on earth. That's a pretty bold statement. And then he says to them, what I want you to do because of this is to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. And so it's a call to go and ask people to follow Jesus Christ. He's saying to the church, I want you to go and spread out throughout the world. And wherever you are, I want you to tell people to follow me. And again, that's a bold statement if he's just an average man. And then it says that he wants people to be baptized in his name. And so they're to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so not only are you to ask people to follow me, but I'm going to ask you to tell them that if they want to genuinely follow, they have to publicly identify with me. They're going to stand in front of a group of people and say, I have decided to follow Jesus, and then they're going to get dunked in the water. And we're kind of used to that in church tradition, and they had some things that were part of that cleansing, but it really is kind of an odd thing when you stop and think about it. I remember one time I did a baptism for a husband and wife, and it was my first time doing that. And I was an associate pastor, but I was friends of theirs. Actually, for those of you that remember Connor and Naomi, this is Naomi's parents. And so I get up there and I introduce the wife, and she shares her testimony, and I baptize her. And then she stands at the back, and then I baptize Lee, the husband. And when I get done, the senior pastor, he says, hey, whenever you do a baptism for a husband and wife, always do the guy first. And I said, well, I was thinking ladies first. He said, yeah, but no woman wants to stand back there soaking wet while her husband gets. And I was like, oh, yeah, that never crossed my mind. So baptize the guy, let him stand there soaking wet, and then baptize the wife, and she can immediately move. And so you know, when you think about it, it's kind of like, well, this is not things. But this is what Jesus is asking them to do. To go and say, you need to follow Jesus. And oh, by the way, you also need to get baptized to publicly stand in front of people and say that you are a follower of Christ. And he says that they're to teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. And so it's, oh, by the way, say you believe in Jesus, become a disciple, get baptized to publicly proclaim that, and that's not the end of it. We actually want you to live the rest of your life following Jesus. We want you to actually live like what you say you believe is what you really believe and follow Jesus. And then he says at the end, and behold, I am with you to the end of the age. And so he gives this statement like I'm always going to be here. Well, if he's just a man, that again, that's a bold statement. So Jesus is saying these things, and he's asking people to follow, and he's saying to the disciples, I want you to go and proclaim this. And then the book just ends there. Like, I kind of think, again, if we disconnect this from Jesus, that there would be some questions. Like, really, all authority? Like, I've worked with guys, and they've come and said, the boss has told me that I'm in charge. And you're like, yeah, really? I'm not sure that's true. But Jesus is saying that. But why is it at this point in the book of Matthew does nobody question? Why does nobody say, I'm not sure I want to go to the ends of the earth. I'm not sure you really have authority. I'm not sure you're really going to be with us to the end of the age. I'm not sure I want to come or go and tell people to follow you. Nobody questions him at this point. Why is that? Well, let's go back and look and see. If you go back to Matthew 27, verses 45 and 54, we're told that on the cross, it got dark for 3 hours. And then when Jesus died on the cross, the temple or the curtain inside the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. And that curtain was the thing that separated the holy place in the temple from the Holy of Holies. And inside the Holy of Holies was the Ark of the Covenant, the throne of God, the mercy seat was in there, and the priest could only go in there once a year, and it was on that Friday when Jesus was crucified, and when Jesus dies, that curtain is torn in two. And it tells us that there was an earthquake, and people actually were raised from the dead. And at the conclusion, look at chapter 27, verse 54. At the end of all of this, we have a centurion who is a Roman soldier who says this. He says, when the centurion and those that were with him, keeping watch over Jesus, saw the earthquake and what took place, they were filled with awe and said, truly, this was the Son of God. And so this centurion recognizes that something very unique has happened, something special has happened, and he says, that guy that just died on the cross was somebody special. He was the Son of God. But notice he speaks in the past tense. He was somebody. But that's not where it stays, right? The story continues. So let's pick this up. Let's look at Matthew 27, 57 through 61. I'm just going to read kind of section by section through this until we get back to where we started at the end of Matthew 28. So Matthew 27, verse 57, we have the burial of Jesus. It says, when it was evening, there was a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who also was a disciple of Jesus. And he went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him, and Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen shroud, and laid it in his own tomb, which he had cut in the rock, and he rolled a great stone to the entrance of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite of the tomb. And so you have this man, Joseph of Arimathea, and he asks for the body. He's going to bury this body. Luke 23, 50 through 51 tells us that he was a believer. In John 19, 39, it tells us that Nicodemus, who is famous from John chapter 3, where Jesus has that conversation about being born again, it tells us that Nicodemus brought 75 pounds of spices. And so Nicodemus was probably somewhat wealthy too. And so he brings these things. They're going to bury Jesus in an honorable way. And even in this, Jesus is fulfilling prophecy. In Isaiah 53, 9 through 12, it says, and they made his grave with the wicked and his rich, and with a rich man in his death. And so while he was killed with wicked men, with a thief on each side, and yet when he comes to be buried, he's buried in a rich man's tomb. He's buried with a rich man, and they put this great stone in front of the tomb. And as a kid, I always thought, well, they were trying to keep Jesus in, which, remember what the centurion said? He's dead. Like, they weren't really worried about Jesus escaping. What were they worried about? Very common things like animals coming in. And then we'll see a little bit later that the priest had some other concerns, so they put a guard there. But that's what they do. And then you have these women that had watched the crucifixion that now come to the burial, and you have Mary Magdalene. And we believe that Luke 8 is talking about her and the fact that she had demons cast out of her and then followed Christ. And the other Mary that it mentions here is the mother of James and John. And then there were just lots of Marys at this time. Miriam was Moses' sister, and it was just a very common name. But you have these women that are there, and they're mourning the loss of Jesus. So you have people that followed Jesus reacting. They want to bury him with honor. You have the women that are following. And then we come to verse 62, and we see the Pharisees' reaction to Jesus' death. They're actually happy that they have finally got rid of him. And it says this in verse 62. It says, the next day, which would be Saturday, that is the day after preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember how that imposter said," so they're calling him an imposter because Jesus said he was the Messiah, he was the chosen one, he was the promised one. That's what he had claimed, and they recognized that. So he says in verse 63, "Sir, we remember how that imposter said while he was still alive, 'After 3 days I will arise.' Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people he is risen from the dead. And the last fraud will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard of soldiers. Go make it as secure as you can." So they went and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard. And so the Pharisees understood that if the disciples came and stole the body, that they could create this myth of the resurrection, and that myth would be worse than when Jesus was alive. It's kind of that old idea that when you kill somebody and they become a martyr, their influence can become greater than it has ever been before. But they don't actually think this is going to happen. They're just trying to prevent a hoax. They're like, we just don't want his guys to come and steal the body and make something then. And so they secure the tomb in two ways. They put a seal on it, so they put a Roman seal on it, and they put a guard there. And can you imagine being sent to that guard duty? We're like, hey, we want you to go stand in a cemetery and just make sure nobody steals the body. Don't worry, there's a big stone there. It'll be no. And I can see these guards being like, this is pretty easy. This is a pretty easy job. We're just going to go hang out in a garden. You know, it's going to be good. Maybe we'll swap some stories. I don't know how they did it back then, what they were allowed. But these guys had to be thinking this is easy duty. But then look at verse 28. I'm sorry, chapter 28, verse 1. It says, "Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb." And so they go, and their natural reaction is to continue to mourn, to go to the tomb, to give honor to Christ, because they loved him. They honored him. They respected him. But he's dead. And so they go and continue in their grief. And then verse 2 says, "And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men." And so there's another earthquake here. There was one when he was on the cross. Here we have another earthquake. The first one marked the temple being torn in two. And here we have an earthquake that tells us again that something major is happening. Jesus has been raised from the dead. And the angel rolls back the stone so that they can go in and they can see what is in there. And this marks the arrival of the messenger. This marks the arrival of the angel. And it says that his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And so when you don't know how to describe something, you just say, well, this is what it was kind of like. This is the closest thing I can get to is lightning. And when I've, you know, when you're looking directly at lightning, it can be blinding. I remember once we lived in Kentucky for 4 years where I went to school, and we're from California, so we weren't used to the big thunderstorms. And so it's thundering one night, and it's kind of cool for us. And Sabina goes in, goes and looks out the window. She's looking down into our backyard, and lightning strikes in our backyard. And I hear her go, "Huh!" And then I hear her go, "I think I'm blind." Because it was just the brightness of it was just so great. And that's how these women are describing that this angel is, his clothes were as white as snow. And it was kind of like lightning, like just the brightness of it. And it's a picture of the glory of this messenger, that he's coming with something very specific. And the guards, it says, become like dead men. And I imagine that I imagine these guards were pretty tough guys. Like, that's why you get that job. It, you know, back then you had to be able to swing a sword and throw spears and armor and all that kind of thing. I imagine these guys were pretty burly, but yet they are terrified. And it says that they became like dead men. They're just scared to death, I think, is what has happened there. And they may even have thought, like, we're going to die. Like, I don't know what's happening, but this isn't normal. Maybe they thought they were under attack by a great multitude with the earthquake and the light and everything, but just says that they're scared to death. And then you get to verse 5, and it says, the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay." So we see just the compassion of the angel right off the bat. He says, hey, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. There's nothing to fear here. And I know that you've come to seek Jesus. I know you're here in grief, and you've come to give that grief. But just those amazing words in verse 6, he is not here, for he has risen. And so the angel is proclaiming this miracle that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. And he reminds him, he says, as he had said. He says, if you remember, he said over and over again that he was going to suffer and die, and that he was going to rise again after 3 days. And so the angel's just reminding them what they already knew, but maybe had forgotten. And so he says, come, see the place where he lay. And so they go in, and they see that the tomb indeed is empty. And then the angel says to them in verse 8, or it says to them, verse 7, then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you so. So the angel says, I want you to go and tell everybody else that he's risen from the dead, and that he's gone before you into Galilee. Because back in chapter 26, verse 32, Jesus had told them, he said, then Jesus said to them, you will all fall away because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee. So Jesus was telling them at the Last Supper, you know what? The way tonight's going to go, I'm going to be arrested, and I'm going to eventually be crucified, and you guys are going to scatter all over the place. And again, just kind of reading into it, I think that had to be just so humiliating for them, right? Is that when all of that happens, rather than stay believing what Jesus had told them, they scatter everywhere. And of course, we know that Peter even denies Christ when he's asked directly. But Jesus told them, when I rise again, go to Galilee. And so the angel wants them to remember that. And verse 8 says, so they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Why does it say fear and great joy? Because something scary just happened, right? Like, we know, we celebrate the resurrection from the dead, but that's not normal. People don't normally rise from the dead. And they just saw this angel that appeared with an earthquake and like lightning, and they're full of joy, but they're also a little afraid, which I think is a proper response when you come face to face with the beauty, the majesty of who God is. And so their hearts are—they're a little afraid. Like, we're dealing with God here. God has done something, Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Son of God. He has risen from the dead. And so while they're filled with great joy, there's also this like just fear of like, wow. So then in verse 9 it says, "And behold, Jesus met them and said, 'Greetings.' And they came up, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him." And so Jesus just comes to them and just with a simple word just says, "Hi." And they come and they worship him. And then Jesus said to them, "Don't be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." So again, Jesus says, "Hey, just wanted to confirm this. I really am alive. Go and tell everybody else, and let's go on with the plan. Meet me in Galilee." And so Jesus appears to them. He reveals himself to them as risen from the dead. He is the risen Lord. The grave couldn't hold him. The tomb couldn't hold him. He did indeed rise from the dead. And then you get to verse 11, and we see the Pharisees' reaction to the crucifixion. It says, "While they were going, behold, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests all that had taken place. And when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said, 'Tell people his disciples came by night and stole him away while you were asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble.' So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jews to this day." So the Pharisees say, "We got to do some damage control. We got to spin this in a way that supports us." And so they bribe these guards to say that the disciples came and took the bodies away. And it says there in verse 14, "And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." Because they recognize that if the soldiers say, "Hey, we fell asleep," the punishment for falling asleep on your post was death. They just executed you. And so these guys are kind of like, "Well, why would we say that? Because the money's not going to do me any good if I'm dead." But the Pharisees say, "Don't worry about it. We'll talk to the governor. We'll keep you out of trouble. Just take the money, spread the word." And as Matthew wrote this, he was saying there were still those that believed this, that thought that Jesus' body had just been stolen. And then we come to verse 16. It says, "Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted." And so the disciples make their way to Galilee. They see Jesus. They worship him. But it says that some doubted. So at this first appearing, for some reason, that there's still doubt in their mind. But we know that that doubt will eventually go away, because out of the 12 disciples, 11 of them will be killed for their faith. And you don't die for something you know is a lie. You just don't. The only one that wasn't killed for his faith was John, and he died in exile on the island of Patmos. You don't die for a lie. And so somewhere along the way, the doubt went away. And I think that doubt just went away as they realized that what they were experiencing was really true. That Jesus did indeed rise from the dead. And that what he says here in verse 18 is really true. And this is where we started, right? Why do they not doubt anything that Jesus says in verses 18 through 20? Why do they not have any questions about it? Because he has proved who he is. Why are they not afraid to go and make disciples of all nations? Because they want other people to know that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. This isn't a call for the church to go and conquer other nations or anything like that. It's a call to go and tell. Like Charles Spurgeon, he said, evangelism, the telling other people about Jesus Christ, is just one beggar telling another beggar where to buy bread. That's all the church is called to here, is to tell people who are dead in their trespasses and sins that they can be forgiven, to go and tell people to follow Jesus Christ because he died on the cross for your sin. We all deserve to die. We all deserve the wrath of God. But on the cross, Jesus died in our place. That is a message worth telling people. And he says, don't just go and tell them, but call them to real faith. Call them to be baptized. Call them to identify with Jesus' death and resurrection in baptism. And so when we baptize somebody, we put them under the water because the word baptize means immerse. But it's also, it's a picture of having, and we say this, having died with Christ, having died to an old way of life, and being raised to walk in newness of life. It's identifying with Jesus' resurrection. That's what baptism is. And we recognize that on the cross, Jesus died and he paid for our sin. In the resurrection, we're given his righteousness. We're given eternal life. So on the cross, our debt is wiped clean. In the resurrection, we're actually given money into our account. We have something applied to us. We have righteousness given to us. And in baptism, we recognize that and we identify with that and we say, yes, I don't just believe this about Jesus intellectually, but I believe it enough to stand up in front of people and say, this is who I am. That's what baptism is. So they're not going to shy back from that because Jesus is standing there. So they're to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So we see that picture of the Trinity there. And then it says, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. So they're to tell other people to obey Jesus for the rest of your life. Again, becoming a Christian isn't just, hey, I believe Jesus rose from the dead, and I'll say I believe that publicly, but now I'm going to live my own way of life. It's actually following Jesus, believing that everything he has given us in his word, everything that he has told us to do is for our good and his glory. Yes. And so we say that we're to follow, we're to teach people how to obey, how to follow him. And so that's what Jesus is calling him to do. But let's go to the bookends of this passage. In verse 18 there says, he begins with, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. I said at the beginning, if you take that statement and you disconnect it from Jesus, it's just kind of like, yeah, why do you have that authority? But this is Jesus saying this. This is Jesus making this claim. And if there is any doubt that he has all authority in heaven and earth, he just rose from the dead. He has power over death. In John 10, 17 through 18, Jesus said, I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. John 11, 25, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. Jesus had the power over life and death. Jesus has authority on earth and in heaven. And he has the authority to forgive sin. Don't doubt his ability. Don't doubt who he is. And then in verse 20, there at the end, he says, I have commanded you. And so he gives us them this command to obey and to follow him. But I love how he finishes this because, again, it's not a command and says, okay, good luck out there. I'm going back to heaven. I'll see you when you die. I hope you make it. Jesus says, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Jesus gives eternal life. He's given us the Holy Spirit. God walks with us through the rest of the life. I am with you always to the end of the age. This is a promise of Jesus Christ. Go back. Let's look at a few verses. Look at John chapter 6, verses 37 through 40. Jesus is talking about being with them to the end of the age, to the last day. And that would be a big question with them, like what is going to happen to us on the last day? And Jesus says in verse 37, all that the Father gives to me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given to me, but raise it up on the last day. For this reason, the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. And then look at verse 44. Jesus says again, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. And so Jesus had been telling them, like, if you follow me, I will raise you up on the last day. And Jesus brings him right back here at the end of the book of Matthew and says, I will be with you to the end of the age. I promised you eternal life. Don't doubt that promise. And what do we look at for that? We look at his authority over life and death. We look at the fact that he rose from the dead. Look over at 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. 1 Peter 1. It's after that big book of Hebrews there. This is one of my favorite passages in all of Scripture. It talks about the inheritance that we have. When you place your faith in Jesus Christ, you become one of his children. And again, Jesus doesn't abandon us. He stays with us. And this is what Peter writes. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials. And so Peter there, he's saying, what is it that we as Christians stand in? What is it that we hope in? We hope in this fact that at the end of the age, in the inheritance, that Jesus will still have us, that we will gain this inheritance. We have, and he says there, we have a living hope. Why do we have a living hope? Because Jesus rose from the dead. We don't believe in a dead prophet or a dead God. We believe in Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, who has promised to carry us into eternity. And we've talked about this before, that sometimes we think the gospel is just putting your faith in Jesus to be saved from your sin. That's the gospel. That's part of it. But the other part of the gospel, that Jesus promises to sanctify us, to grow us, to make us to be more like him through life. He doesn't abandon us. And then kind of the last part is the promise to carry us into a glory. Part of the good news of the gospel is that God will carry us into eternity and give us eternal life. That's the gospel. That's good news. And you need to know that that's available for you. Yesterday, I was spent way too long trying to put in a garage door opener that still doesn't work. I crossed a wire. Lights are red that shouldn't be red. I don't know why. But I'm out there, and I'm trying to look up on my phone, like, what does this red light mean? And these two girls walk into the driveway, and they have the little black job badges on, the two sisters. One was from Texas, one was from Utah. But they asked me, they said, they asked me if I went to church, and I said, yeah, I go to Woodward Park Baptist Church. And they said, well, what's your favorite thing about your faith? And I said, my favorite thing is the confidence that I have that when I die, I will spend eternity with Jesus Christ. And they were like, that's a pretty good one. They didn't say it exactly right that. But they were like, yeah, that's good. And I said, you know, Romans 8, it's one of my favorite chapters. And I talked, there's no condemnation with Christ, and he adopts us, and there's nothing that can separate us from the love of Christ. And in their faith, they just don't have that confidence. They're like, well, yeah, we look forward to eternity as well, and we just hope we make it there. You can know for sure. You don't have to hope that maybe you do enough good things, because you never will do enough good things. We stand in confidence that Jesus' death on the cross paid for our sin, and that his resurrection from the dead will carry us into eternity. He has the power over life and death, and we stand in that confidence. We know that that promise is real, that Jesus will be with us even to the end of the age. And since I just mentioned it, go back to Romans chapter 8. Look at verse 26. I've told Sabina before that when I die, just, you know, gather together, read Romans 8, say amen, and go home. I want to tell her what you should eat too, but why should you eat what I like? Because I'm going to be with Jesus. But look at the end of Romans 8. What I'm trying to build here is this confidence in the resurrection, this confidence that if you put your faith in Jesus, that you know for sure what's coming next. And I do this because if you're here and you've never placed your faith in Christ, I hope you will do that. I hope you will do that this morning. It's just as simple as you having a conversation with God right where you are. But I also do this because I know that even for those of us that have put our faith in Christ, life is hard. Life is hard for everybody. And sometimes there are just those times where we doubt and our confidence wanes and our confidence lacks. And I heard somebody say one time, they said, you know, if you ever doubt whether Jesus loves you, just look at the cross. He died for you. And then we get this promise here in Romans 8, verse 26. This is a little bit of a long passage, but just hear this. It says, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And that's just saying that Jesus was the best of men. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is interceding for us. What shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The resurrection is the exclamation point at the end of Jesus' life in which he says, you can trust me in everything. I have authority over heaven and earth. And behold, I am with you to the end of the age. This is what we stand on as Christians. That Jesus is indeed King of kings and Lord of lords. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. And because of the resurrection, there is no need for us to doubt his ability to save us, his ability to hold us, his ability to carry us to glory in heaven. And the mission of the church is simply to tell people that good, good story. Let's pray. God, we thank you that in your grace, in your mercy, you sent Jesus to die on the cross. God, we thank you that we can know for certain that our sins are covered. God, we thank you that you wash us, you cleanse us, you set us apart, you justify us, you make us right according to the law, God. And God, we thank you that through faith in Jesus, people like us who deserve punishment and deserve wrath can come to your throne with confidence and say, Jesus covered my sin. God, we thank you for the resurrection that reminds us that you have power over everything. Lord, we pray that we would live in that confidence. We pray that our hope would be living. We pray that our hope would be active, that we wouldn't shy back as we live in this world. God, we love you. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing one more song together. While the band comes, just take a few minutes and talk with the Lord. There will be some of us here at the front. If you'd like to pray about anything or If you have questions about Jesus, you can come ask us or just ask somebody sitting near you. They would love to share with you the good news of Jesus Christ. Just take a moment and talk with the Lord.
Would you stand quietly? And I'd encourage you, even as we sing, if you need to come and talk to one of the pastors. We're going to sing a medley of two old hymns. Christ the Lord is risen today, and up from the grave he arose. Ming? Christ the Lord.
Let me close our time with our benediction out of Hebrews chapter 13. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.